start to get connected, and we'll break out like we did last time. If you haven't gotten your sheet with the verses and the questions, it's on the music stand right at the back. Grab one, and you can follow along with Sandy in the NASB version as she reads to us tonight. But anyway, let me just get us started by praying over Sandy and our time together, and then we'll get going back into part two of Galatians. God, we just thank you for your Holy Spirit that is always ready to teach us. God, give us a posture of being a learner, that we can hear this ancient letter that is so relevant to us, the church today. God, just give us ears to listen and a mind to understand, and speak to us through your word. And we pray a special blessing on Sandy as she teaches tonight, and then give her clarity and understanding of what she wants to say. Give her words she never even thought of, and keep out anything that you might want to not talk about. And we just trust you, and we praise you, and thank you through your son's powerful name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank you. Well, good evening. Welcome back. Let's hope it doesn't rain, because it gets real loud in here, is my understanding. So tonight, Galatians, His Grace That Works. Karen, thank you for praying for us. That was the first thing on my notes, so she covered that. I started high school at the height of the Vietnam War, 1968. So I just gave you my age. Oh, I'm 68. In high school, I started in 1968. And with President Johnson approving an increased maximum number of U.S. troops and American dollars in Vietnam. Meanwhile, the countercultural movement, the hippies, had emerged across college campuses, rejecting the mores and the traditions of American life. But in 1968, I was a freshman in Southern California in a Catholic high school in my plaid uniform, looking like this. But in my head, and I confess on many weekends, I look more like this. And Mr. Plutko was my ninth grade freshman history class teacher. Now in those days, anyone who knew anything, anyone that you were going to listen to, had to be totally cool, and they had to look like this. But Mr. Plutko, my history teacher, he wore a flat top crew cut. He wore a plaid suit jacket with a tie and skinny pants. And he kind of looked like that. That might be Mr. Plutko, I'm not kidding. He looked just like that. Anything but groovy. But Mr. Plutko was impassioned about history. And he was deliberate in his teaching us the roots of our nation, as he perhaps saw the foundations crumbling before his straight-laced eyes. I wasn't much interested in history back then. I didn't see the value in hearing stories from long ago. I just wanted to be accepted. I wanted to be a part of the in crowd. And I'd been captivated by those who dressed and marched to the beat of a different drum. And I was drawn to that promise of peace and love. And it would take years for me to discover that the offer of peace and love in the ways of the hippie lifestyle was a blatant false promise. And I've often thought back to those days in Mr. Plutko's history class, who was in reality probably the one that was really marching to the beat of a different drum, who held to the truths he believed in and refused to be swayed by the sweeping culture. And I often wish I had cultivated a love of history back then. But thank God it's never too late. And somehow, as I read this letter to the Galatians by Paul, I thought of Mr. Plutko. And I was reminded of that freshman history class. But this time, I was a willing and an eager student. And I was listening in to Paul in what I can relate to as a classic, impassioned Plutko style, schooling his misinformed students and perhaps reluctant Galatian learners in the essentials of his story, of his personal history, in order to validate his message. Now, last week, we were reminded of Paul's authority as an appointed apostle of the one true God and of our only possible hope for peace and love. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins so that he might rescue us from this present evil age, to whom be the glory forevermore. Amen. And now Paul wastes no time driving home his point. History class was now in session. And through his words, Paul would remind the churches in Galatia that it is his grace that works throughout history. It is his grace that has worked always throughout all the history of mankind. As Paul picks up addressing the Galatians, he cannot contain himself. He is utterly amazed. I am amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the gospel, by the grace of Christ, for a different gospel. Now, this word amazed in the Greek, it's thaumazo, and it comes from the noun thauma, which means a wonder or a marvel. And the verb means to wonder at, to be amazed, to marvel, to be astonished, out of one's senses. Do you hear Paul? He's out of his senses. He's awestruck. He's wondering very greatly. He's regarding this whole situation with such amazement. And the verb means there's a suggestion of beginning to speculate on the matter. You're awestruck and you're speculating. So Paul expresses this is the state he now finds himself in, speculating on this matter that's beyond comprehension. How could these believers in Galatia desert God's grace? Inspired by God, it's more than safe to say that that was God's heart as well. How can you desert the gospel of grace? Had they already forgotten their own history? As recipients of the most miraculous heart transplant in all of history, they were in essence requesting their old dead heart back so they could return to their old dead works. These Galatians were buying into a false gospel peddled by false teachers, a message that was twisted and sure to end in trouble and confusion. And doesn't it make you wonder, how did it happen so quickly? Within 10 years or so, Paul would write the letter to the Colossians, warning them of the danger of false teachings. In 2:8, he says, "See to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception, according to the tradition of men, according to the elementary principles of the world, rather than according to Christ." Paul's warning speaks to us all. There's danger out there, as clearly seen in these churches in Galatia. And it didn't take long for those deceptive philosophies of man to take these believers captive. Besides Paul's many exhortations, corrections, and teaching, Paul's letters are also filled with prayers. He prayed for openings to preach the gospel, salvation for the Jews, joy and faithfulness in affliction, endurance and unity, overflowing hope, peace and strength, for believers to live in God's grace, share his comfort, walk in his victory. Paul prayed for generous service, for God's sufficient grace to be perfected in weakness, for freedom from anxiety through prayer and thanksgiving. And Paul prayed for himself, that he would fearlessly proclaim the gospel in the face of persecution, and he prayed with thanksgiving, confident that God would be faithful to complete what he began. Paul prayed. He prayed a lot. He prayed for believers a lot. But there is an overarching theme that Paul prayed for his beloved brethren. His prayers are not about material needs being met or physical illness, which we can definitely pray for those. But Paul was obsessed with one major topic in his prayers for believers, that believers increase in their knowledge of God through God's truth and the power of the Holy Spirit. So we're going to look at just a brief snapshot of some of those prayers. In Ephesians 1, he prayed a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. So their heart would be enlightened so that they will know. In Ephesians 3, he prayed they'd be strengthened with power through the Spirit so they could comprehend and know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge. Know the love of Christ, an experiential knowing that surpasses knowledge. It's a heart knowing that surpasses the head knowing, the heart knowledge that comes by faith. In Colossians, he prayed that the knowledge of his will would fill them with wisdom and understanding so they would increase in the knowledge of God. In Philippians, he prayed that their love would abound. How? In real knowledge and discernment. In Philemon, he prayed that their faith would become effective. How? Through knowledge of every good thing that is theirs in Christ. And Paul was wholly convinced of the believer's eternal security. Never once did he pray, "Oh God, don't let them lose their salvation." Never once. But he did pray for all believers, a prayer that we can pray too, to grow in the knowledge of Jesus. For this would not only influence the way they live their lives, but it would protect them from those deceptions of man's teachings and traditions. This knowledge is to be our safeguard against the schemes and the lies of the enemy. So how do we grow in the knowledge of him? We spend a lot of time in our study in James being reminded that God has called us to a faith that works, to not deceive ourselves and just be hearers of the word, filling our heads but not our hearts, because faith without works is dead. James said, don't merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself. Do what it says. And Jesus himself said, everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them may be compared to a wise man who builds his house on a rock. But think about this. Both James and Jesus were speaking to us based on the assumption that we are hearing God's word. We cannot do what something says. We cannot act on something unless we first know what that something is. God has given us the only means where we can truly know and hear him. Jesus said, these words of mine. His holy word. Oh, we can definitely glean things about him from creation, and we can definitely learn from messages from pastors or podcasts and from people who love Jesus and encourage us in our faith, but no one is perfect in what they know about God. If we really want to know him, if we really want to hear him and do what he says, we must meet him in the place that he has provided for us, his holy, infallible word. From the beginning to the end, Genesis to Revelation, every bit reveals him and his grace that has been at work throughout all of history. But he certainly does not invite us to come to his word to merely fill our heads. That is, after all, what Jesus rebuked the Pharisees for. He said to them, you search the scriptures because you think in them you have eternal life. It is these that testify about me. The Pharisees were so busy looking for what they thought they were supposed to see that they totally missed seeing Jesus. Listen to this quote by Norman Doughty, Christian theologian and author, regarding this truth as recorded in the Complete Green Letters by Miles J. Stanford. I quote that book a lot. It's incredible. You can talk to me afterwards. I highly recommend it. It's a book on the principles of spiritual growth. Doughty says this, come to the word for one purpose, and that is to meet the Lord. Not to get your mind crammed full of things about the sacred word, but come to it to meet the Lord. Mm-hmm. Make it a medium, not of biblical scholarship, but of fellowship with Christ. Behold the Lord. This is not on my notes, but I got to share it. If you're in my small group, you've heard this story. When Sarah, who's now 37, was 3 months old, I went to a woman's house to sit under this 86-year-old woman who was leading in a Bible study. And she taught on 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is inspired by God, but the NIV says is God-breathed. And this little old frail, tiny little 86-year-old woman in this easy chair that was engulfing her opened her Bible, and she said, when you open your Bible, feel his breath. God breathed. When you're close to somebody, a friend, and you're telling secrets and you can hear their, feel their breath in your ear, isn't that incredible? That's the way we need to approach his word. Oh, your breath. It changed me. It absolutely changed me. Behold the Lord. Feel his breath. Oh, that we would come to his word fully expecting to see him revealed. And this was Paul's mission and his heartbeat. Preach the one who had revealed himself by divine revelation. And from this passionate relationship, Paul denounces the delusions that were being peddled by these false teachers. Galatians, how are you turning away from grace for a different gospel? Verse 7, which is really not another. Only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. These false teachers were offering a distorted message. Now, if I offer you a glass of water, and I tell you it's pure filtered water, and then you see me take an eyedropper of sewage and add it to your glass, how likely do you think you're going to be to gulp that glass of water down?
That's a negative.
Paul's letter to the Galatians was going to give his readers everything they would need to detect the sewage that was watering down and distorting the gospel of grace. But just like a glass of water with an eyedrop of sewage could no longer be called a glass of purified water, this perverted gospel could not really be called the gospel at all. And I think it's pretty safe to say that it really wouldn't matter who offered you this glass of water with a drop of sewage in it. Your most idolized celebrity, or the most spiritual person we know, or even a heavenly being, we would refuse to accept this contaminated drink from their hand. And it's likely that we would want them charged with some crime for this wrongful act that would surely cause harm. Well, Paul, too, called for these false teachers to be charged, tried, convicted, and sentenced. 8 and 9. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we've preached to you, he is to be accursed. As we have said before, so I say again now, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you receive, he is to be accursed. This word accursed means something that is pledged to destruction. We must take seriously the warning to guard the integrity and purity of Christ's gospel of grace. But again, we cannot guard the gospel message if we're unsure what the message is. And so, as to instruct us all, Paul begins to recap his own personal history. Necessary because the Judaizers had challenged his apostolic authority. It's not easy when people challenge our faith. And we may not feel as though we have all the answers, but what people can't challenge is our story, our personal history. And when those accusatory questions fly in our face, like, what about such and such, and what about this? We can answer truthfully. I'm not sure about that. I'll try and find the answer. But I can tell you what I am absolutely sure about. Let me tell you what Jesus has done for me. Paul's history would validate the gospel he preached, the gospel he had received from Jesus Christ, beginning with a reminder of what his commitment to preaching the gospel had cost him. For am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ. Paul begins with his motivation. It has nothing whatsoever to do with others. The Judaizers accused Paul that in order to make the gospel more appealing to the Gentiles, he was making up this message of grace and freedom from the law. But Paul draws a sharp contrast. It is utterly impossible to please both God and man. The Bible definitely has something to say to those who seek honor and favor from men. The obsession of being a people pleaser. Seeking honor and glory for self is an absolute impediment to faith. Listen to what Jesus said in John 5. I have come in my Father's name, and you do not receive me. If another comes in his own name, you will receive him. How can you believe when you receive glory from one another, and you do not seek the glory that is from the one and only God? Seeking the approval of man entangles us in the fear of man and can paralyze us in our ability to stand for truth. It's what happened to the rulers in Jesus' day. Nevertheless, many of the rulers believed in him, but because of the Pharisees, they were not confessing him for fear that they would be put out of the in crowd of the synagogue. For they loved the approval of men rather than the approval of God. But when we seek God's approval, we can stand before Him unashamed, like Paul. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God who examines our heart, 1 Thessalonians 2:4. And Paul stood before his Lord unashamed, as one who had subjected himself to the sole purpose of pleasing God as a bondservant of Christ. Oh, that we would have that confidence. Now, in some versions, this word bondservant that Paul used in verse 10 is also translated as slave or servant. In the Greek, doulos, it means bondservant or slave servant, one who is subservient to and entirely at the disposal of his master, a slave. Under Roman law, a bondservant was considered the owner's personal property, and slaves essentially had no rights at all. And also in Roman times, the term bondservant could refer to someone who voluntarily served others. The Hebrew word for bondservant had a similar connotation. The Mosaic law allowed an indentured servant, one who had been enslaved to pay off a debt, to become a bondservant voluntarily. It was written in the law. But if the slave, there's the Hebrew word eved, plainly says, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I will not go out as a free man. Then his master shall bring him to God, then he shall bring him to the door or the doorpost, and his master shall pierce his ear with an awl, marking him, and he shall serve him permanently. In declaring himself a bondservant, Paul stripped himself of any sought-after titles, of dignity, of respect, as he declared his undying love for his master and his surrender to serve Christ permanently. And with his identity established, Paul begins to walk his readers back through time, through the story of his conversion, depicting the radical redirection of his life's trajectory from that of a proud Pharisee to that of a humble bond servant. We're going to do our best this evening to go through a bit more of Paul's history, but a very condensed version, beginning with how he received the gospel message as he wrote in verse 11. For I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man. For I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. And Paul will point all of us who read this letter to God's true gospel, his grace that works throughout our personal history. Besides learning of Paul's conversion story from Luke in the book of Acts, when Christ appeared to him on the road to Damascus, Paul himself wrote about how he, an appointed apostle, received the gospel of grace through divine revelation. In Ephesians, he wrote, assuming that you've heard of the stewardship of God's grace, which was given to me for you, that by revelation there was made known to me the mystery, as I wrote before in brief. By referring to this, when you read, you can understand my insight into the mystery of Christ. By referring to the fact that I received it by revelation, you can understand that I have insight into the mystery of Christ. Why? Because Christ himself revealed it to me. Which in other generations, verse 5, was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets in the Spirit. The gospel Paul preached was given to him for others, revealed in the Spirit. When defending himself to the church of Corinth against false prophets and their boasting, Paul reluctantly shared of the amazing revelation he received in 2 Corinthians 12. This boasting will do no good, but I must go on. I will reluctantly tell you about visions and revelations from the Lord. I was caught up to the third heaven 14 years ago. Whether I was in my body or out of my body, I don't know. Only God knows. Yes, only God knows whether I was in my body or outside my body, but I do know that I was caught up to paradise and heard things so astounding that they cannot be expressed in words. things no humans is allowed to tell. Paul's gospel was supernaturally received in paradise, in the very presence of the astounding Almighty God. And so his history class continues, explaining what could have possibly transformed a man like Saul into the man Paul. And in verse 13, he continues, "For you've heard of my former manner of life in Judaism, how I used to persecute the church of God beyond measure and try to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my contemporaries among my countrymen, being more extremely zealous for my ancestral traditions." Now, what's interesting to note, Paul is not claiming zeal for God's word that contains the law, but for the traditions of his ancestors, those traditions orally passed down. Mark 7:5 refers to this adherence to traditions of the elders that the Pharisees and the scribes were so extremely zealous for. The Pharisees asked Jesus, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat their bread with impure hands?" And Jesus replied by quoting the word, the prophet Isaiah, "This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the teachings of men." In other words, that their adherence to the tradition of the elders was not worship. It was mere lip service resulting in a head full of tradition rather than a heart full of faith. And it was this adherence to the ancestral traditions that became the catalyst for Paul's advancement in Judaism. So let's see how Saul the Pharisee was advancing. In Acts 7, we read about the first martyr. "And they had driven him, Stephen, out of the city. They began stoning him, and the witnesses laid aside their robes at the feet of a young man named Saul. They went on stoning Stephen as he called on the Lord and said, 'Lord Jesus, receive my spirit.'" The next verse picks up in chapter 8. "Saul was in hearty agreement with putting him to death. And on that day, a great persecution began against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Some devout men buried Stephen and made loud lamentation over him. But Saul began ravaging the church, entering house after house, dragging off men and women. He would put them in prison." And on his mission to ravage the church, Paul's history takes a dramatic turn. "And as he was traveling, it happened that he was approaching Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him, and he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?'" Jesus takes the persecution of his children very personally. "And Saul answered, 'Who are you, Lord?' And he said, 'I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and it will be told you what you must do.'" Paul met the resurrected Christ, the living Jesus. And when that happens, radical things happen. And with just three little words, the obsessed Pharisee was transformed into the obedient preacher. With just three little words. "But when God." But when God, who had set me apart even from my mother's womb and called me through his grace. Paul, like the prophet Jeremiah, was consecrated, called, set apart, and appointed to proclaim the gospel of grace. God wrote to Jeremiah, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nations." And the fact is, ladies, each of us are known before the womb. And if we belong to him by faith, we too are chosen and called for his glory by his grace that works through his true gospel in all of history past. We have been chosen and called before the foundation of the world by his grace that works according to his timing and his pleasure. In Ephesians, we read, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we would be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ himself, according to the kind intention of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved, his son. Before the foundation of the world, we were chosen. We were predestined to be adopted as his children. Why? To bring him glorious praise. It is his grace that works through his true gospel throughout all of history to accomplish the kind intention of his will. Hear that. The kind intention of his will. And from the outset, Paul would be divinely instructed by the Lord to rely solely on his kindness, his grace that works to reveal the true message of the gospel. It was only Jesus Christ and his work of grace that could possibly transform this Pharisee into the preacher of the gospel of grace. And Paul would not be schooled by any human. His teacher would be the resurrected Christ, the living Savior whom he had personally met on the road to Damascus, who had called him and set him apart even before the mother's womb, and called him through his grace and was pleased. Pleased to do what? To reveal his son in me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles. And I did not immediately consult with flesh and blood. Paul was transformed by the living Savior to do what? To go to the Gentiles. Now imagine that. Saul, the Pharisee, who had most certainly dedicated his entire life to being separated from those heathen Gentiles and intentional in staying clear of becoming defiled by anything unclean. He was set apart even from his mother's womb to spend the rest of his days with the very ones he had worked so hard to avoid his entire life. I love God. But that's what happens when the Son of God takes up residence in the heart of believers. He realigns our life to reveal his grace that works. And Paul the Apostle continues making his point that his gospel of grace was divinely revealed because he did not go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me. But I went away to Arabia and returned once more to Damascus. Paul didn't make his way up to the religious headquarters to receive instructions from the who's who of the church. Now, the details of Paul's time in Arabia and return to Damascus are not detailed in the book of Acts. But according to Paul, he didn't consult with any human, including the apostles, regarding the gospel message for 3 years. Then, 3 years later, I went up to Jerusalem to become acquainted with Cephas. And I stayed with him 15 days, but I did not see any other of the apostles except James, the Lord's brother. Paul felt it necessary to explain that the purpose of his visit was to merely become acquainted with Cephas, which is the Greek name for Peter. And his time there only lasted about 2 weeks. And Paul details that besides James, the Lord's brother, he didn't see any other apostles. So essential was this part of his story that he basically takes an oath before God to say that what I'm telling you, Galatians, is fact. Now, in what I'm writing to you, I assure you before God that I am not lying. That's serious. Paul was not lying. After this, his brief 15-day in Jerusalem, Paul continues to travel, but not into Judea, but into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, verse 21. But he had still not personally met any from the churches in Judea. In verse 22, he wrote, I was still unknown by sight to the churches of Judea which were in Christ. Paul, once so hell-bent on destroying the church, had become God's chosen vessel, chosen apostle, to establish and build the Gentile church. And though he had not physically made his way into that region of Judea, as the saying goes, his reputation had preceded him. But only, they kept hearing, he who once persecuted us is now preaching the faith which he once tried to destroy. Paul was preaching the faith he had so laboriously endeavored to utterly annihilate. Why? Because he had an encounter with the living, resurrected Christ, and his life was instantly and eternally transformed. So how could he do anything but preach the faith? And isn't that how it should affect us? It begs the question, does our reputation precede us? We too have seen the living, resurrected Christ in his living word that proclaims his grace that works through the true gospel of Jesus Christ, who brings light to what was darkness and life to what was once dead. As Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He who follows me will not walk in the darkness, but will have the light of life. John 8:12. And that, ladies, is fact. Our faith is in facts, not in imaginations. Paul was so completely changed because he knew and experienced firsthand that the gospel is true. And though Paul knew he was undeserving to receive such grace, he still knew his faith was unshakably founded on the unshakable reality that it is his grace that works through his true gospel. As he wrote in Corinthians, for I am the least of the apostles and not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of Christ. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me did not prove vain, but I labored even more than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God with me. And the truth is, all of us are unworthy and undeserving of such immeasurable grace. That is one of the facts of our faith. His grace is his gift. Unmerited, undeserved, unearned. And Paul understood the facts of his faith revealed in his past history. And though he knew he was undeserving, his faith was not based on the facts of his own merits or his own works or on his feelings, but on the fact of God's grace that works. Here's another quote from Miles J. Stanford, Complete Green Letters, about facts, the facts of our faith. True faith must be based solely on scriptural facts. For faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, Romans 10:17. Unless our faith is established on facts, it is no more than conjecture, superstition, speculation, or presumption. He continues, Hebrews 11:1 leaves no question regarding this. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith standing on the facts of the Word of God substantiates and gives evidence of things not seen. And everyone knows that evidence must be founded on facts. His grace works through his true gospel throughout history. And his grace works through historical facts. The historical fact of his chosen people, of his prophets, of his son, of all of us who have become his children through faith. And Paul was willing to endure as a bondservant, willing to face the ridicule of men, willing to lose his reputation because he knew the facts of his faith. He had a personal encounter with the living, resurrected Savior who had revealed himself to Paul, an absolutely undeniable fact. Paul could entrust himself to Jesus because he knew Jesus. And the result? And they were glorifying God because of me. It's his grace that works to bring him glory forevermore. 1:5. And Paul was able to glorify God because he trusted God. But the truth is, we can't and we won't trust anyone any more than we know them. And that is why we must fall in love with his holy, infallible, God-breathed word that reveals his grace that works throughout history from Genesis to Revelation, for it is his story, all of it. And this is where we will truly come to know him. We must never forget that ignorance is dangerously destructive, and false teachings must be devoted to destruction. And as we've seen today, it's critical to our faith that we know history, his story, as preserved in his holy word, that we too would grow in knowledge of him through faith in his grace that works. For it is his grace that works throughout all history to call us and set apart his own for his purpose and for his glory. Amen?
Amen.
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 Heavenly Father, we thank you just for the gift of your word, God, that we have access to so much. Lord, let us not take that for granted. Lord, please grow in us that hunger to know you more, not to get a head full of facts. We need the spiritual, scriptural facts, but that they would lead us to knowing Jesus. So, Lord, I pray for each of us here today that we would love your word more tomorrow than we did today, that we would hunger so much for your word. We thank you for your Apostle Paul giving us the hope that we don't deserve your grace. We too are so unworthy. We're the least of all your children. But your grace is greater than that. And we say thank you, Father. So I just pray, God, that you would continue to grow us in the knowledge of Jesus, that we would grow in our faith, grow in our trust, and grow in our understanding of